Three things happened this past week that grabbed my attention. First, I have seen an incredible outpouring of love. Love our us. I've seen an incredible outpouring of love in the form of detergent, food, and even, literally, taking artwork off our walls to help feed hungry people. Such treasure among us. You are treasure. Given our God-given desire to help others. Treasure. Yeah. Second, we had two funerals. I know you know this. 1 week ago, Saturday, for Nancy Willis, at age 61 years old, of all things, a youngster. The other for B. Morgan, 98-year-old mother B. Taylor. The funerals remind us we are also clay jars, not just treasure, clay jars, subject to deterioration and death. I don't know if you felt it, but funerals drag us down a little bit. What was the rain? Finally, we were told this week that our affordable housing project will be awarded tax credits. The tax credits that we need. Congratulations to us, huh? Wow. Thank you to God. We have hurdles. Tell you a little bit about that at our congregational meeting later. But the day we celebrate, the day is for celebrating. Because it's God who's brought us this world. See, until this later thing happened, this latter thing, getting the tax credits, I was focused on the story of Samuel for today. Focused on what Samuel teaches us about hearing and accepting God's call. We know this story. We are living this story. Even though, unlike Samuel, who was probably 12, we're not children. Samuel was to be the last of the prophet judges of Israel, and after Samuel, there would be kings. Samuel was the end of an era. We are more like Eli, who was past his prime, but ever so gracious in doing what God asked. But as I said, we did get the news for which we hope and pray. Today is a day. We're celebrating and giving thanks to God for leading us this far and buying artwork in thanksgiving. Given this news, we now need our epistle lesson. Why? This lesson begins, we do not proclaim ourselves. We proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves, to paraphrase and mix metaphor here, as mere workers in Christ's vineyard. There are large portions of the vineyard that are unlit with the light of Christ, unlit with the very light that God brought into our world. We work in God's vineyard, but that vineyard, our world, can be a very dark place. We know, you know, I know, God dispelled the darkness, God dispelled chaos itself, pushed the void away, made the void subject to the order God created to hold the darkness away. Then God created the stars and planets, and he gave our world a spin to separate day and night. And God created us and gave us some of his light. And while we have life, our function is to share God's light with the world and witness to the world that darkness does not win. That's our message. Darkness does not win. But darkness hides in each of us. Jesus taught us how to witness to God's light, how to let God's light shine in and through us. Jesus also showed us that as bearers of God's light, we can endure all things, even death. Because of what Jesus wore, we know that we too can bear all things without letting darkness win. In our epistle lesson today, clay jars. Ponder that, a treasure in clay jars. We humans, in fact, all living things, contain the light of God, a glimmer of God, the life spark that animates us. God's light is a great treasure. And when we let God's light work in and through us, we live in God. Acts chapter 17, verse 28 says this much more poetically. In God we live and move and have our being. Put yet another way, we each contain God light to share with the world. And as I mentioned earlier, the darkness is in us also. Remember what Paul said in his letter to the Romans? We do what we don't want to do. We don't do what we ought to do. Darkness hides in us a bit. And we die, and our God light leaves us, or seems to leave us. The light moves on, and we move on with it, returning to God, as the clay jar of our body gives up its God light. Paul says the reason we must give up our God light, the reason we must die, is so we don't forget we are not the source of light and life, so that we remember always that God is the light, and we are mere God bearers. The treasure we carry, God's light, dispels the darkness. So Paul reminds us today, we're each to die for the cause of Christ. By our death, by our very attitude to our death, we witness to life itself. My theory is only the very old and the very ill want to die. Life is too precious to give up, at least while there is light to share and darkness to dispel in our world. Yet, as we say in our funerals, even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Okay, Joe, might be thinking, we get what Paul told the Corinthians to encourage them in their faith, despite their hardships. But, Joe, we're not being persecuted, are we? So how does this scripture lesson possibly apply to us? In our Bible study this week, I got a little help. Consider how we have experienced treasure in clay jars, to use Paul's metaphor. The ones we thought of, the ones we shared anyway, both relate to our church building here at Church of the Resurrection. And I'm sorry for the ones sitting under the leaf. You can move, eh? Hey. That's a great example, isn't it? Here's our first example. Our beloved former preschool, which we gave away a couple years ago. Accomplish our redevelopment plans. It's a treasure in a clay jar. The treasure was the kids. The cutest kids, other than yours, on the face of the planet. With all kinds of disabilities and abilities all playing together. The space downstairs in which we house Resurrection Children's Center was so increasingly out of step in comparison to facilities at other preschools that we lost more and more marketability or more market share each year. The school was a great treasure, as were the teachers and the children. The classrooms that housed the school were definitely a clay jar. It's example one. Worship in this space is a great treasure, isn't it? I think so. Here we let our God light mingle, shine, even dance a little bit. We've shared that light with our children over the decades, with each other, and with every single person God has sent our way. As we know, God sent them for a reason, for them and for us. But the lights and the roof and that HVAC system and a whole bunch of other things routinely these great treasures. You, us, together, for worship, for music. These two examples of treasures show that we can get so enamored of the treasure, we can overlook the clay. Maybe your own life contains a treasure in clay jars. Maybe your treasure has been encased in clay so long you can't even fathom how to break free. Or maybe you've forgotten the clay is even there. You don't have to remain stuck. The way we are does not have to remain the way we can be. Especially because Jesus is the greatest life changer. And if you ask him, he will set you free. And if you ask us, he'll help. I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.